He is Damon Amendola of the DA Show on CBS Sports Radio. Catch him on Sirius XM 206. The show goes 6 to 10, so here in San Antonio and in throughout South Texas, 5 a.m. to 9 a.m., the DA Show. At Twitter, he's at DA on CBS. DA, I want to talk a little hoops here. The Last Dance documentary, it's brought Jordan, it's brought the Bulls, that dynasty with the Bulls, and it's brought 90s basketball, and the 80s to a certain extent, back into the limelight. And we've heard a lot of talk about the documentary itself, but one of the things that's kind of coming from, especially in this day and age where there's no sports going on, so there has to be sports discussion now, taking the place of actual games and practices and what have you, is comparing the 90s to now. Now, a lot of it comes under the umbrella of the Jordan-LeBron discussion. I'm not so much concerned about that, so much I am just in terms of just general comparison between 90s hoops and today's hoops. Now, I've heard it pointed out, and I think there's some merit to this, that a lot of us who cover sports nowadays and who kind of write the narratives nowadays grew up with some nostalgia in the 90s, even if we maybe some of us were a little bit older and already working in the business, that there's this romanticism with that era in Jordan because, as human nature would tell you, the past is almost always better than what's going on now. Want to get your take. I know you grew up in New York, so you grew up with those Knicks teams. And one of the things I've heard is, you know, those 90s Knicks, kind of like those 90s Pacers with Reggie Miller, they really weren't that great, but we've elevated them because of the Jordan Bulls rivalries. Your take, 90s NBA to today's NBA, where are you?
Well, yeah, I think it's human nature that the things that you grew up with, you always value most. There's nostalgia that sweeps over you when you see things from your youth. It automatically transports you back to a happier, simpler time in your life. It's just a human condition. Things that used to happen to you feel way better now that those things have passed, and we romanticize. So the 90s NBA is no different. I do think 90s NBA was one of those peaks because there were so many superstars, so many captivating personalities throughout the league. It wasn't just Michael Jordan, but the Knicks were really interesting with Patrick Ewing. Hakeem Olajuwon was super interesting with the Houston Rockets. Clyde Drexler, incredibly interesting when it comes to, you know, the Blazers. Charles Barkley in Philadelphia and Phoenix. The Supersonics with Gary Payton and Sean Kemp. The list goes on and on. David Robinson in San Antonio. There were so many interesting teams. Reggie Miller in Indiana. The end of the Bad Boys in Detroit. I mean, the list goes on and on. Dominique in Atlanta. So there is a realistic romanticism that should happen about the 90s because it was so captivating on so many levels.
My take on the 90s NBA compared to now, look, I'm with you if you want to look at those 90s Knicks and say, okay, outside of Patrick Ewing, I mean, come on, John Starks, Anthony Mason, Charles Oakley, Derek Harper, you know, that's not a fantastic core. But then you also have to take in consideration context. Like, if you look at the last 10 years of the Eastern Conference in the NBA, I mean, is that Magic team led by Dwight Howard and Jameer Nelson, as we get further removed from that team, was that kind of a great team? Those Atlanta Hawks that ended up with the number one seed like in 2016, was that a great team? You know, the DeMar DeRozan, Kyle Lowry Raptors teams that were among the best in the East for several years, were those great teams? I mean, I think every decade is going to be littered with teams that aren't this super collection of talented players, because the ones that are either win the whole thing or also get to the final. So this notion that when you look back at the 90s Knicks or the 90s Pacers with Miller and Smits and the Davis boys, and you know, it's just not a great collection of talent. Well, yeah, but that's true of every generation. I mean, that's the reason why the Lakers and the Celtics were the Lakers and the Celtics. Nobody else had those rosters. So to hold those Knicks and those 90s teams to those standards, I think is silly, especially when, like you mentioned earlier, the 90s is filled with guys who, to this day, you would have a hard time keeping out of top 20 NBA players of all time lists.
Yeah, I think that's fair. And I think that part of the Knicks being iconic is that they're a bit of a Shakespearean tragedy, is that the Knicks exist in New York. New York's supposed to be the Mecca of basketball. The Knicks have not been good since those years. So it's the last thing Knicks fans have to hold on to. It's the last thing New York has to hold on to in terms of basketball. And Patrick Ewing has a tragic type of career in the fact that he's the number one overall pick. Everybody's tanking to get him in 85. He ends up in the mecca of basketball, and he can never win a championship. And I think if the Knicks win in 94, maybe they're not seen as Ewing and a bunch of bad scrubs. I think if they go to an NBA Finals in 93, because they knock off the Bulls in that Eastern Conference Finals, maybe they're not seen as a bunch of bums. But the fact is, because they came so close, and because they lost, and because Ewing was so great, but because they lost, the fact that it was a team led by Pat Riley and a bunch of rough and tumble emotional guys that were willing to fight you at every break, and they went against Michael Jordan, that they will always hold a certain place because of the losing. And that's kind of a rarefied spot, because you mentioned the Pacers. We don't think of the Pacers in these romantic terms nationally. But the Knicks get that. And I think that the pain of the Knicks fans, I mean, the 94 Rangers were simultaneously with the Knicks trying to do the same exact thing. Break a long streak, win a championship in New York City in the mid-90s. The Rangers did it. And that 94 team is iconic and looked at as beloved and, you know, the maybe the most beloved team in New York sports history being a hockey team. I mean, it's in that conversation. The Knicks, it's a tortured history, and that kind of perfectly encapsulates not being able to beat Michael Jordan, the Bulls, all of those times in the 90s.